Tonight on Beyond the District, we see how one tiger is making news and see how lots of people are getting into the fall spirit.
Beyond the District will return in 2 minutes.
I'm Alexia Evgeniu, and welcome to TV21's Beyond the District.
And I'm Logan Summer. Later on tonight, we will take a look at how your cat can help you lose weight.
But up first, tonight, we take a look at how a 12-year-old girl is recovering in the hospital after she fell into an open sewer manhole. Officials say the girl was trapped in a foot of rushing water for nearly an hour. Ed Riley has more.
Oh my God, I was terrified. I was praying that she was okay.
All day long, family members of 12-year-old Grace Knox were on pins and needles, waiting to hear how the 7th grade student was doing after falling into this uncovered sidewalk sewer manhole. Around 2 p.m., an update.
How's Gracie?
She has to have surgery.
Oh my God, what, her leg?
Yeah, on her ankle. She shattered her ankle.
At Women and Children's Hospital, Grace's father told us his daughter normally walks to Southside Elementary School with her 9-year-old brother, Jake. But today, Jake was sick.
And she was walking, and all of a sudden, she said that she was just in the bottom of the sewer.
For close to an hour, the young girl was stuck in the hole, standing in 2 feet of cold water. When she was finally rescued, first responders found she had a broken ankle and a very low body temperature.
All tests came back negative, so she's okay in that regard, too.
Thank God. Thank God for that. Thank God.
When Grace fell, she dropped her cell phone, and it was a bypasser who finally heard her screams for help.
I just want to say to him personally thank you, and God bless you for that.
The big question now, why was the manhole open? A neighbor who lives next to the manhole told us he was sure it was covered last evening, leading many in the neighborhood to wonder if someone opened it overnight.
Unknown people out there that are doing these things that are harming our children.
For Grace's family, relief.
She would have stayed down there much longer. She wouldn't have made it. She would close the hypothermic up.
Okay, well, don't think about that, okay? Just don't think about that. Just think about that she's safe, okay? Because that's all I was thinking, okay?
Up next, if you're looking for pumpkins to decorate your home this October, you may want to look somewhere else. The gourds this Wisconsin couple is growing might be a little too much for your front doorstep. Eric Peterson has a look.
It's 6 foot by 6 foot, so it's taller than me.
At about 5 feet tall, Julie Faust says this giant gourd is one of the biggest pumpkins yet. Her husband, Del Faust, agrees.
That one got to, I'd say, about 1,700 to 1,800 pounds, which is good.
The pumpkin is one of 10 Faust raised on this property northeast of Fond du Lac. He says the giants have a voracious appetite.
We feed them a lot of organic compost and fish oils, kelp.
These plants also need a lot of water, about an inch per week. The Fausts use this pond nearby to pump the liquid to the giant pumpkins.
This one was growing at 43 pounds a day for 2 weeks.
That's 602 pounds.
That was the peak, and then it tapers down. And
Faust says weather from a cool, wet spring and then summer didn't help.
Like this last week when we had 90 degrees, pumpkins don't like it 90 degrees. and they don't like it at 40 degrees. They don't like the fluctuation.
Sometimes I wish I were a pumpkin.
Faust says the squash are pampered. Fans run 24/7, keeping the stems cool and dry. Heating coils in the greenhouse ground give young plants a helping hand.
You always try to do different things to make your pumpkin grow bigger.
The Fausts grow the gourds to compete in Wisconsin Giant Pumpkin Growers contests around the state. This one is headed to Nakusa on Saturday.
It's a great hobby. We have a lot of friends that we made because of growing pumpkins, so that's cool.
In Fond du Lac County, Eric Peterson, Fox 11 News.
Now, working out is a great stress buster, but what happens when you add a cat to yoga practice? Lindsay Slater brushed up on her Savasana to find out.
About yoga with cats, hi baby, is they have minds of their own and they tend to be the teachers of this kind of class.
You've got to be kidding me. Easing the mind and body with a little bit of fun.
They're adventurous.
Susie Mella teaches kitten yoga class at Happy Tails Pet Training in Greenfield. Her students love the idea.
I think it's a great idea to get exposure to the cats, exposure to the group, and hopefully there'll be less homeless cats on the street.
The cats come from Happy Endings Animal Shelter, the oldest no-kill animal shelter in Milwaukee.
People can expect probably the most fun time they've ever had with yoga. You will get run over by kittens. You'll be able to play with them. You might be able to get some yoga done. Depends on you. But the kittens will certainly make it entertaining.
Now, there actually is a point to doing yoga with cats. So by the people that are attending the class, hopefully some of these little kittens can get adopted.
The first class led to a pair of adoptions. Jennifer Nowak, owner of Happy Tails, hopes to offer it once a month.
They all leave with smiles on their faces, which is what we want.
In Greenfield, Lindsay Slater, WISN 12 News.
Next, canines working with cops have become pretty common, but not every police department is choosing to work with shelter dogs. But that's how police in La Vista, Nebraska are doing it. Sean Everson has the story.
Meet Mickey. This 6-year-old bull terrier mix meeting his new partner for his first day on duty.
One of the shelter dogs is going to be a canine cop for the day and is going to go out with one of the La Vista police officers.
The new Canine for a Day program is a partnership with the La Vista Police Department and the Nebraska Humane Society, bringing awareness to dog adoptions.
It seemed like a win-win for both of us, where we could definitely continue our programs with involving our community, but also help the Humane Society find a great home for a great dog.
Oftentimes, animals that are out of this environment have a better chance of getting adopted if people see them in a normal environment rather than here.
Mickey rides up front as his patrol begins.
Well, buddy, we gotta start tweeting this out. Get you adopted, get you a home.
Even receiving his own badge at the La Vista Police HQ.
So get out in the community and do community policing that we definitely embrace and hopefully help the Humane Society find a great home for Mickey and other dogs in the future.
His energetic personality, a plus, as he makes new friends at the Costco in La Vista.
We want to get a dog that's really friendly, that's very comfortable and social with people.
He gave you a big kiss.
Hoping one of them will bring him home soon.
Now we are going to take a short break, but coming up, we take a look at how one IHOP waiter saved the day.
And we also take a look at one man who is always has a smile on his face.
You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one. Imagine.
Hello.
Can't. I'm busy right now.
That's the way we get by. To the way we get by. All that. The way we get by. To the way we get by. That's the way we get by. To the way we get by. To the way. That's the way we get by. That's the way we get by. We found a new kind of dance in a magazine. Try it out. It's like nothing you ever seen. Your sweet talk like a cop.
Welcome back. An IHOP waiter from Texas went from serving pancakes to serving up some justice on a would-be robber. Turns out the bad guy messed with a third-degree black belt. Emily Balcom has the reports.
When two men and a woman walked into this neighborhood IHOP, waiter Elijah Arnold said something just didn't seem right.
And when I stepped into the galley, I just got that feeling where I just needed to wait and listen.
5 to 10 minutes later, he heard the register pop.
That's really the sound that haunts me, because that's the sound that put me into action.
And put his third degree black belt to the test.
So I like ran up, he like swung the crowbar at me. I like blocked with this arm, and then I hit him with this hand, and then like pulled him to the ground. But during that process, I don't know if my face hit the register, hit the ground, or just hit him in the face both, because he had a scar on his head and I have a big old bloody nose now.
Arnold held the suspect down until police got there.
I mean, even on the ground while I was holding him, he was begging me, like, please let me go, give me the money, I'm going through a bad time, you know, you should understand this.
The thing is, Arnold does understand hard times, more than the suspect could have known.
2 weeks ago, I wasn't working, I was homeless.
He just got this job, just got this new work shirt, and had just scraped together enough cash to get this car.
I got new tires on the back of my car yesterday, and then I got a flat today.
He certainly knows the value of a dollar enough to fight for it.
That was my money in the register. It was my manager's money in the register, and it was my IHOP's money in the register, and I'm not going to let anybody take that.
Up next, a 6-year-old boy in Kansas wants to be a police officer when he grows up. He says they are his heroes. On Friday, he set up a treat and invited them to stop by as a thank you. Kelly Gibbs has the story.
It may not be an official uniform, but that doesn't stop young Officer Oliver from serving his Overland Park community at age 6.
I want to be nice to police officers because I'm doing a donut stand for police officers. Got chocolate ones.
With refreshments and 100 donuts.
Kind of tire ones.
Oliver is hoping to spread a message of gratitude to the men and women in blue.
They're my superheroes.
For now, it's passing out donuts, a miniature police car, and a dream of one day keeping these streets safe. Overland Park Police Chief Frank Donchez says he sees a lot of potential.
We want to hire people that have a passion for the job.
And that's great news, because for Oliver,
I don't need Spider-Man, Superman, Batman. I need these guys.
Now the long nights and days spent bringing in the sugar beets from around the region can wear on a worker, unless you have Todd Bergman in the field with you. The Lake Park man has faced many obstacles in his life, but making people smile is not one of them. Kevin Walland has the more.
You'd be hard-pressed to find another sugar beet field in the valley today, where Woody from Toy Story is helping clean out the truck boxes of dirt and tailings.
The hat, it's just, this doesn't come with it. It's just, this is, just fits perfect.
This is Todd Bergman. He's 38. And the costume thing, well, it's every day. It all started
2 or 3 years ago. He has a bunch of old men, and they couldn't give him a smile. I was cheery, but they couldn't give him a smile, so I thought, I'm going to cheer these up.
And so, to make people smile while harvesting beets 24-7,
12 costumes.
Todd started buying costumes from Walmart.
They have a special section for the onesies. And
how much?
They're $19.88 a pair with tax.
Ninja Turtle, Harry Potter, a unicorn.
I have 3 different kinds of Batman. And I have a Wolfman costume.
Todd has made quite the name for himself. In fact, traffic has picked up on the gravel road. People are curious what he's wearing on this day.
All day long. I mean, they drive by just to see what he's wearing.
And the sugar beet truck drivers?
But I think the Ninja Turtle's my favorite.
Well, they just can't get enough of Todd.
He's always having fun, that's for sure. Like, I don't think I've ever seen him in the dumps. He's always been hyped up, which makes a lot more fun.
But life for Todd Bergman hasn't always been fair.
I'm just thankful that I'm able to do this, because the doctor said there's no hope. I'm a walking miracle. I don't like to brag, but that's the truth.
In 2001, a near fatal car crash next to the Buffalo River changed everything.
5 months I was in a coma. It basically changed my life because, well, obviously.
A head injury left him unable to do much of anything.
I had to learn how to walk and talk and do all that. And
he went from hospitals to nursing homes to a rehab center.
Yeah.
Just to learn how to live again.
There's a reason that that God saved my life.
And so this, a 38-year-old who dresses up in the middle of a sugar beet field just to make someone else's day.
The whole thing is, I'm not normal.
After nearly losing his life, Todd has decided it's time to live it, one costume at a time.
It is now time for another break. Coming up later in the show, we will take a look at how one grandma is still on a roll.
Beyond the District, we'll be right back.
When your day is long and the night is yours alone, when you're sure you've had enough of this life, hang on. Don't let yourself go.
Welcome back to Beyond the District. I'm Alexia Evgeniu. Kitty Weston-Nauer is one 69-year-old grandma who would rather be on wheels. The BMX racer showed off her youthful skills at a track in Indiana. Since she was 40, his mom coaching him from the sideline, so he gave her a saying, "If you think this is so easy, why don't you try and say the rest? As they say, is history." Kater Kapowska has the story.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
69-year-old Kitty Weston-Nauer got hooked on BMX riding almost 30 years ago.
That was probably the most thrilling, exciting, invigorating experience.
She's the oldest female BMX racer in the country and still winning championships.
Okay, so I am 69, big deal. Age is nothing but a number.
Sometimes she competes against women much younger than her, and sometimes even against men.
Why do I continue to race the sport? Number one, fun. Number two, more fun. And number three, even more fun.
She also loves how it keeps her on her toes.
You can look at a track and you will say to yourself, whoa, that's easy, until you get to that particular obstacle.
Several years ago, Kitty got both her hips and knees surgically replaced. But that's not something that could keep this lifelong biker down. The wheels just keep spinning as she continues to inspire the world.
Doesn't matter that I come across the finish line first, or second, or third. I always finish. And as I tell people, every time I get on my bike, I win.
Next, Hurricane Irma has come and gone, but thousands of people are still waiting for relief. As Silva Harpeta reports, many lined up at the sites across Florida to apply for assistance from the federal government.
Welcome back from Irma.
It's back to school time again as South Florida works to get back to normal after Irma.
And nothing spells out normalization of a community than kids returning back to school.
Good morning.
Miami-Dade Superintendent of Schools Alberto Carvalho making the rounds Monday.
Good morning.
Finding all but one campus back in business. Still some cleaning to do at Richmond Heights Middle.
Have a great day.
So those students are in classrooms at nearby Coral Reef High. School also back in session in Broward County.
I'm glad that everything is getting back to normal, that, you know, we survived this.
Young minds ready to get on with growing.
I like school and I like learning.
And they will also be getting free meals for a while.
Until the end of October is to provide free lunch and free breakfast to every student.
Miami-Dade County doing the same.
Don't forget, free breakfast, free lunch for everybody.
And both school districts praising the faculty and staff.
And I just wanted to say thank you.
Their hard work getting students back in school as quickly as possible. Like the principal of North Hialeah Elementary, who after the storm rode 15 miles on his bike to check on his school, then fired up the chainsaw and got to work.
And rented a truck to haul debris. I mean, that's commitment, yes. Right?
Now we check out how a Colorado mom is doing what she can to fight teen suicide. She's taking a proactive approach trying to address mental wellness at a young age, and she's doing that through yoga. Reporter Kyla Galler takes a look at the new program in Colorado Springs.
What happens when we're super busy is the end result of that is stress. Do you guys know what stress is?
These kids might only be in fourth and fifth grade, but they do.
A lot of kids have stress these days, like pressure for school and work.
For about 1 hour each week before the first bell rings, they're taking that stress and channeling it through yoga.
You take your right leg and you put it over your left. And maybe you just keep your foot here for balance.
Kimberly Wilson, who started the 12-week program, is a certified yoga instructor and mom. She tells me she had to do something when she saw the spike in suicides.
Over the last three school years, 14 students have died by suicide across District 20. When that happened, of course, as a parent, I'm trying to think of what can I do to help this problem. And I think we're all searching for answers. I don't believe that yoga is the answer to this, but I believe that it is a tool that we can use.
While most of the teens who have died over the past few years were older than these kids, Wilson hopes these classes will act as a proactive approach to mental health. And so far, it seems to be working.
It relaxes me from my brother. He is really stressful to me. It helps me kind of find my center and calm.
I get stressed a lot and it helps me with that. It helps me calm down when I have frustrations or worries.
The kids do typical yoga poses.
Airplane, we've got ourselves a dancer, we've got a mountain pose.
But they also journal and talk about what's going on in their lives.
I like this class because of my teacher. She's really kind.
And listens to our thoughts.
You don't have all that anger if it's stored up in you. Sadness, it just goes away whenever you're doing this. I'm guessing I want to spend the rest of my life doing this.
So next time you're stressed, take a breath and a pose. Namaste.
Wrapping up tonight's show, we take a look at how a tiger that escaped from a truck ended up wandering around backyards near an interstate in Georgia. It ended badly for the tiger, but it was a happy ending for the dachshund. CNN Gene Moose reports.
It's not the usual cat you'd expect to see in the yard at 6 in the morning. Take it from Brittany Speck and her husband.
And he was like, oh my gosh, it's a tiger. And I lost it.
At her home in Henry County, Georgia, outside Atlanta, Brittany was awakened by police lights and the sound of her dachshund, Journey, outside on a lead, barking hysterically. Police had gotten 911 calls about the tiger near Interstate 75.
Unfortunately, it jumped a fence and went after a dog back behind one of the residents here.
By the time the tiger had gotten my dog, that's when they started shooting.
The tiger's deceased. Officers did use force, firearms to put the animal down.
Police had called animal control professionals and were waiting for them to arrive with tranquilizer guns when they felt they could wait no longer, what with kids soon headed for school. Felt Entertainment, the parent company of the now-closed Ringling Brothers Circus, told CNN that the tiger was being transported by truck along with other cats. The truck stopped in Georgia overnight. A 6-year-old Bengal tiger named Susie escaped unnoticed and wasn't discovered missing until the truck arrived at its destination in Tennessee. A representative for Felt Entertainment called the incident a tragedy. What's it like to look out in the yard and see a tiger?
It's definitely not like going to the zoo at all. My husband looked at me and he was like, is this a dream? Like, are we still sleeping? And no, that thing was massive.
Especially compared to Journey, the 9-year-old dachshund, the dog was shaken up but okay with just a few scratch marks.
It looks like a paw.
Right after the tiger attack, Journey met the press.
Takes on a tiger, tail still wagging.
And tongues wagging over the tail of a tiger where it shouldn't be. Jeannie Mo, CNN, New York.
Remember, if you have a story you would like us to cover,
or if you have an announcement about an upcoming event, please send it to Interschool Mail, the TV studio at High School East, or you can email us at tv21@trschools.com. Also, be sure to tune in TV21 throughout the day to catch this show and Tom's River Regional Schools Today as we bring you stories from around the district. Also, please take a look at our website, www.trschools.com/TV21.
Well, that's a wrap for tonight's show. For Beyond the District, I'm Alexia Evgenyu.
And I'm Logan Summer. Have a great night.